the British people for what they have done. And next, I want to say that the settlement of the Czechoslovakian problem, which has now been achieved, is, in my view, only the prelude to a larger settlement in which all Europe may find peace.
The Prime Minister's first call was on the King at Buckingham Palace, where scenes of folk, women of Britain, but of you wives and your children, your babies. For the front line in modern warfare is the defended the fate of Europe, and the lives of millions. Not for his message in Kai above us all. So to cheers of encouragement, this grey-haired Knight of Westminster went in search, not coming halfway, to meet, in the German Chancellor's words, so old a man. On the outcome of this attempted pacification, his coming to Heston, Mr. Chamberlain had a great moment, took leave of them for his journey to Munich. His unquenchable spirit, his indomitable will for peace, overrode his 69 years and gave him a strength beyond his age. For this time, Herr Hitler was included these words. Here, to commence our story, is the Sportpalast Berlin. Many of you probably heard Herr Hitler's speech, felt its temper, at times sensed even a ferocity, as the German Chancellor vilified President Benesch and whipped his tremendous audience to fervor in the cause of the Sudeten Germans. Well, this was the if they were not given to him. The German fleet, too, was ready for war. Indeed, practically the whole forces of the country were on a war footing, especially perhaps the strongest arm, the army of the air. Such was the background before which the German Chancellor made his challenging speech. But in that speech, Mr. Chamberlain saw a ray of hope. He made yet another appointment with Herr Hitler, and with all His Majesty's ministers at Heston bidding him Godspeed on his last great effort to avoid war. But Britain still prepared to meet the enemy. If reason could prevail, Mr. Chamberlain had a chance. But if Herr Hitler proved implacable, then wholesale destruction limit the number of the killed and wounded. The camp were waiting but for a word. Destruction and slaughter was inevitable. Our home precautions could only hope to their homes and gave up their identities as peaceful citizens to be known by numbered discs, putting down the tools of their trade and taking up a rifle. The ray of hope in the meeting of Hitler, Mussolini, Daladier, Chamberlain at Munich was but a ray. The adverse will of one man could extinguish it. Scores of squadrons of loaded bombing planes. Whom would that word be given? Signor Mussolini, with Mr. Chamberlain's agreement, desire, arrived at Munich to take part in the momentous discussion. Such a meeting. Herr Hitler, the meeting became an accomplished fact, and four leaders of the world's greatest powers converged on the new firehouse at Munich on the first day of its opening. From France came Monsieur Daladier, grim-faced, unsmiling. No doubt he felt he was meeting an enemy face to face. His reserve von Ribbentrop was deputed for this duty. Followed by many officials, Mr. Chamberlain walked processionally down the line of his guard of honor, his expression inscrutable. Remains civilization to be expunged by culture. If that makes sense, madness must indeed be genius. With a kind of irregular stateliness, Mr. Chamberlain and entourage slowly advanced to the imposing firehouse entrance. Herr Hitler debouched from the familiar open Mercedes car, the modern ruler's chariot, and does the same. A few moments afterwards comes Monsieur Daladier. The meeting of these four men should show either how near man is to the angels or how little above the brute. Last of the historic quartet to enter the firehouse is the Duce, giving his good offices to his friend Herr Hitler and to those who badly shook his friendship over Abyssinia. The peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. In London, reflected glory falls almost riotously upon Mrs. Chamberlain. So much so that when out for a walk, she was recognized in the affectionate demonstration of the crowds waiting for the Prime Minister, made police assistance to get home quite a necessity. Even so, she was patient enough to pose for the press cameras in Downing Street before entering number 10 to await the triumphal arrival of her husband. 118 were seen. The world's opinion is that Mr. Chamberlain has achieved everything that the unstinted, unremitting efforts of a great statesman in a horrible dilemma could do. He has saved Europe's soil from being plowed with flame and manured with flesh. Who will take the responsibility of saying that his choice was not well taken?